God has shown his love throughout the ages to mankind in every aspect of his life, and even in our lives today. And sometimes it seems that, and I'm talking to me, it seems that I get so caught up and I forget that God loves me and he's already set things in motion.
Amen.
I bring you greetings from the historic Florence Church of Christ, where we labor, when we're coming up on 3.5 years now over at the in Florence, Arizona, where the Word of God is being preached.
Amen.
I thank you for your time, and I thank you, the congregation, and for allowing me to be here in your presence this evening. It's been a long day, but I get excited about the Word of God.
Amen.
And if you know me, I get very excited, and I don't care who's looking, and I don't care how I feel. All I know is I care about the Word of God and pleasing God and encouraging souls for God.
Amen. Amen.
My topic for this evening comes from the book of Psalms, a Psalm of David, Psalms 23, a well-known psalm, but he only gave me one verse, verse 1. And I looked into this and I studied this and I said, well, what is he trying to do to me? It seems like every time we go, I come here, this is my fourth, I think fourth or fifth relationship here, praise God. What are you trying to do to me, Brother Lewis? So I say, okay, you think he's smart. But he said, don't take too long. And I'm like, oh, I'll give you the whole counsel of God's word to make sure I cover everything. So, the Bible reads in Psalms 23, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. God loves provides. God loves provides. The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. The Lord is, church, our shepherd. We shall not want.
Amen.
What does it mean, the Lord to be our shepherd, and we should not want? As we ponder God's word, and we read through the inspired pages in the book, why would we want anything? Why should we seek after anything God has already provided? And not only has he provided for us, he provided out of love. As we define the word shepherd, a shepherd is one who is responsible for the safety and welfare of the flock. He will graze the animals, herding them into areas where the good food is, keeping a watchful eye out for danger. God is our shepherd, a great leader. We are the sheep of his pasture. We are the flock. And as a good shepherd, God is always going to, because of his love and his mercy and his goodness and his grace and his kindness, shall I continue on.
All right.
God will always care for the sheep of his flock. The people of his pasture, Christians, us, who trust him and commit themselves to him. He will always nurture us, and he watches out for us, knowing that the enemy is at hand like a roaring lion, like a wolf waiting to search out the weak in the pack. God is always watching. The Bible tells us that the Lord is our shepherd. We shall not want. But what does this mean today for the Christian? Now, I'm going to talk about this evening the things concerning God as being our shepherd, Jesus the great shepherd, and things circling the church, concerning the church. He tells us in 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 25. 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 25. For ye were as sheep going astray, but are now returned unto the shepherd and bishop of your souls. Our love has provided a way to keep us from our hurt, harm, and danger, and from losing our souls. this alone, brothers and sisters. That's right. We have to work together and keep encouraging one another. We need to stand firm on the Word of God. Allow the Word of God to lead us. This rod of God, the staff of God to lead us. Look at Him, look to Him as the great leader, the shepherd, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And follow Him. Not allow our personalities and conflicts and disagreements to allow us to lose our way. Because when we stand on self, we become weak. We go astray. But now Peter says here, for ye were as sheep going astray. We were all lost in sin. We were. Even today, if you will, sometimes if we're not careful, we will become astray. We'll go astray.
Right.
But he said, but now return unto the shepherd and bishop of your soul. God provides. God's love has already provided everything for the church, everything that we need. If we just continue to follow Him.
Right.
He says in verses 21, backing up in verses 21 through 24, for even hereunto you were called, my cousin.
Yeah.
Because Christ also suffered for us. This is what God provided now. Because of the love for us. Watch this now. Christ also suffered for us, leaving us an example that we should follow His steps.
Right.
Who did no sin, neither was guile found in His mouth. Why is there guile in our mouth? Verse 23. Who, when He was reviled, reviled not again. When He suffered, He threatened not, but committed Himself to Him that judgeth righteously. God knows what's going on. God knows how to deal with things. He knows how to deal with the world issues. He knows what's going on. This is the safest place to be. I ain't talking about the building. I'm talking about the place in Christ Jesus.
Amen.
Being in Christ, I'm talking about a New Testament Christian. I want to be distinct. We're in the safest place. God knows what to do. He knows how to do it better than you and I. He says here that concerning God's provision, based on His love for us, verse 24, concerning Jesus, His Son, who His own self bare our sins in His own body on the tree, that we, being dead to sin, should live unto righteousness, by whose stripes you are healed. God has provided. Psalms 21:23, verse 1. The Lord is our shepherd. We shall not want. What are you looking for? What else do we need? He's already provided. He provided Jesus. Hebrews chapter 13. Hebrews chapter 13. Verse 20. Now the God of peace, that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. The blood of Christ will never fade away. The blood spilled from Calvary's cross will never lose its power. You and I who have put on Christ in the watery grave of baptism, we have participated, Brother Nate, in the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. Don't you know that? The Bible tells us in Romans chapter 6, verse 3 and 4, that you are buried with Christ. Not only did we die with Christ, we've been buried with Christ.
Amen.
But as He was, we died with Him, and He was buried, and as He was raised, we were raised up also. So when we have gone, those of us who have gone down the watery grave of baptism, we were buried with Christ.
Amen.
And just as Christ rose, we rose from the dead too.
Amen.
And the blood of Jesus covers us, cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Praise God. God provided that.
Amen.
Praise God. I'm happy to be a Christian.
Amen.
I went to work today.
already provided. My salvation, my joy, my happiness, and abundant life. Let's look at John chapter 10. John chapter 10. In John chapter 10, verses 11 through 18. Come on, your mom. We're talking about the Lord is our shepherd. We should more. John chapter 10, verse 11.
Love. His love has already provided this love. His
Provide. Why did God go through such lengths? We read already that we were like sheep on a string.
Amen.
But God had to fix this thing a long time ago. In the book of Ezekiel chapter 34, we are going to see why. God has already set up the nation of Israel. God has already set things in order. God has already put things in place to help the people, to nourish the people, to look what the people need. In Ezekiel chapter 34, God set up shepherds among the people, gave them instructions and gave them commandments and told them how to feed the flock and nourish the flock, that it may go well with them. But these shepherds became unfaithful. In verse number 2 of Ezekiel chapter 34, excuse me, the Bible reads, Son of man, prophesy against the shepherds of Israel. Prophesy and say unto them, Thus saith the Lord unto the shepherds, Woe be to the shepherds of Israel that do feed themselves. Should not the shepherd feed the flocks? Should not the gospel preachers tell and speak the truth in love? The whole counsel of God's word? When we know that there's sin in the camp, sin needs to be, it needs to be addressed.
Right.
Not forsaken. And verse number 2, the flock was not being properly fed. And verse number 4, brothers, they didn't care for the needs of the flock, but they abused them. He says here in verse 4, the disease have ye not strengthened, neither have ye healed that which was sick, neither have ye bound up that which was broken, neither have you brought again that which was driven away. Neither, that's talking about going out and get the souls that have strayed away. Neither have you sought that which was lost, but with force and with cruelty have you ruled it. Well, God has already set this thing up to care for the people. And yet, as a result, in verses 5 and 6, the flock was scattered and fell victim to the prey. We're not talking about sheep and goats. We're talking about the spiritual people.
Right.
Remember who once tasted the goodness of the Lord, and now they don't show up anymore. Mm-hmm. They're gone. Having been offended and have left the body of Christ for whatever reason. Because of a lack of love. Possibly. I don't know. But in verse 5 and 6, he says that they were scattered because there is no shepherd. And they became meat to all the beasts of the field when they were scattered. Some Christians have lost their soul because they left the church. He says, My sheep wandered through all the mountains and upon every high hill. Yea, my flock was scattered from the face of the earth, and none did search nor seek that. Let's not talk about evangelism right now. That's for another day. So let's hear what the Lord will do in verses 8 through 16 for his sheep. God loves, provides.
Nah.
Our Father shows us his love. Well, if you're not going to do it, get out of the way and let another person do it. Let one who has the zeal for God, the love for God, and the care for souls, don't hinder him or them. Don't hinder them. Let them do what they need to do.
Right.
Don't complain about why they're doing this when you're not doing so.
Right.
You know, I'm often told when I'm out there sharing the gospel, even among my own family members, leave people alone. What gives you the right? You don't judge me. Why do you think you're doing this and doing that? Because I love your soul.
Right.
Hear what the Lord God will do. In verse number 8, he says, As I live, said the Lord God, surely because my flock became prey, and my flock became meat to every beast of the field,
because there was no shepherd. Neither did my shepherd search for my flock, but the shepherds fed themselves and feed not my flock. Therefore, you shepherds, hear the word of the Lord. Watch it now. He says, behold, I am against the shepherds, and I will require my flock at their hand, and cause them to cease from feeding the flock. Neither shall the shepherds feed themselves anymore, for I will deliver my flock, that's what God's going to do, from their mouth, and that they will may not be meat for them. For thus saith the Lord God, behold, I will both search my sheep and seek them out. Praise God.
Amen. God.
Praise God. That God loves us so much, he will come after us.
Amen.
He will search us out. He'll search for the broken heart. He'll search for that downtrodden soul. One who is seeking salvation, and one we don't even know, but we're sharing God's word, who's looking.
Right.
Since when that our baptism has been done with someone without that hasn't been seeking?
You're right.
Bible says in verse 12, as the shepherd searches out his flock in the day that he is among his sheep that are scattered, so will I seek out my sheep and will deliver them out of all the places they have been scattered in the cloudy and dark day. And I will bring them out from the people and gather them from the countries and will bring them to their own land and feed them upon the mountains of Israel by the rivers and in all the inhabited places of the country. I will feed them in the good pasture and upon the high mountains of Israel shall their fold be. They shall lie in a good fold, and in a fat pasture shall they be upon the mountains of Israel.
Amen.
God is going to do this. He had, through the prophet Ezekiel, Brother Curry, God says, I'm going to do this. And we all know, according to Joel 2:28, that in the last days God poured out his spirit upon all flesh.
Amen.
Praise God. The church was ushered in through the preaching of the gospel, of the good news of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Jesus being the good shepherd that God has provided. Is now feeding the flock. I got to hurry on. God loved, provided a good shepherd. Luke chapter 1:32. He shall be great and shall be called the Son of the Highest, and the Lord God shall give unto him the throne of his father. He's talking about Christ. That high shepherd.
Right.
That great shepherd. Back to our text. And Psalms 23. Psalms 23, verse 1. The Lord is my shepherd. The Lord is our shepherd. I shall not want. We shall not want.
Amen.
Let's get the context of that. What is it that the shepherds wanted to provide, Brother Lewis? What is the shepherd going to give us that we shouldn't want in? He says here, in verse 2, he's going to lead us to green pasture. He's going to lead us to still to beside still water. Our souls will be restored. We will walk in paths of righteousness. Every soul will be comforted by the rod and staff of that great shepherd. A table will be prepared in the presence of our enemies. Life will be filled with goodness and mercy. And one day if we are found faithful, we will dwell in the house of the Lord for all eternity. Praise God.
Amen.
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 God.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Amen.
God's love has provided a place today. It's a place of peace. It's a place of joy. Brother Stuart. A place where we can have communion and fellowship with one another and with God. Especially on the first day of the week.
Yes.
It's a place where all of God's grace and spiritual blessings are found. And it contains the seal of our salvation.
You're right.
What am I talking about? I'm talking about concerning what God's love has provided. In verses 3, Ephesians chapter 1, verses 3 through 8. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, watch this now, with all spiritual blessings.
Mm-hmm.
We pray that places in Christ. According as he has chosen us in him before the foundations of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Now watch this. Now God loves to lie. The Father showed his love to us. We ought to be also show our love to him.
Right.
Yes.
Why? Because he has predestined us into the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself. According to the good pleasure of his will. To the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he had made us accepted in the beloved.
Yeah.
God, we love the Son. And us being in Christ, God accepts us as his Son and loves us. Wherein he had abounded towards us all wisdom and prudence. Yet that's not enough concerning the church. That's talk about the church. In verses 10 through 14 of chapter 1, God set this up now. God's love set this up before the foundations of the world. That in the dispensation, in the fullness of time, he might gather together in one all things in Christ. In one what? In one place. The church. The church of Christ. Both which are in heaven and which are on earth. In whom also we have obtained an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of him who worketh all things after the counsel of his own will.
Mm.
God set this up now because of his love. His love has divided a place.
Mm-hmm.
He's God. That we should be to the praise of his glory who first trusted in Christ.
Mm-hmm.
How? You know, the question is, as I share the gospel, out there are made to people in that area. So how does one get into the New Testament church? How do one become a Christian? How does one receive the grace of God? Well, in verse 13 it says, in whom you have also trusted, and ye have heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation. In whom also after that ye believe, ye are sealed with the Holy Spirit. Which is the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession unto the praise of his people. I ain't finished with the church. How do you know it's the church, Brother McDaniel? Glad you asked. Because in Ephesians chapter 1, verse 22, 23 says, and he had put all things under his feet. God has put all things under Christ's feet and gave him to be the head over all things to the church, which is his body. The fullness of him, the fullness of God, that filleth all of them. Everything we need, everything we hope for, eternal life, is in Christ. And God has put all grace, wisdom, salvation in Christ in one place, and that's the church.
Amen.
Amen.
The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not want. I'm not finished. In chapter 2. Verse 4 of Ephesians. But God, who is rich in mercy for his great love, he hath loved us, even when we were dead in sin, hath quickened us together what? With Christ, by grace you are saved, and hath raised us up together and made us to sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus.
Mm-hmm.
That's God's love that has provided. I'm still not thinking. Verse 12, that in the times you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel and strangers from the covenant of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. But now in Christ, in the church also, in Christ Jesus, ye who were sometimes far off are made nigh by the blood.
Amen.
Amen.
For he is our peace, who hath made both one, and had broken down the middle wall of partition, having abolished in his flesh enmity, that's the law, the commandments, can't pay you more, so on and so forth. All this is what God has provided in one place. In chapter 3, verse 9, in Ephesians, I'm still in Ephesians, I'm talking about the church, what God has provided. What the love of God has provided. Now, it's that simple. God has provided love for all of mankind by his grace in one body.
Amen. Yes, sir.
In Christ Jesus. In order to be to access God's grace, you got to get in Christ.
Amen.
Chapter 3, verse 9. Mm-hmm. And to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Christ, by Jesus Christ, to the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be made known by the church
the manifold
or complete wisdom of God.
Amen.
According to the eternal purpose which he purposed in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen.
God purposed it in Christ, the church. It was in the mind of God before creation that the church, that Christ would build his church.
Amen.
That the church of Christ would be the place where man shall be saved. All men, verse 9. He wants to make all men see what is the fellowship of this mystery. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 7. He says, but unto every one of us is given the grace according to the measure of the gift of God. God's grace in Christ is a gift to the church, is the gift of the church to benefit the whole body. Again, God's love is provided. Everything we need is in the church, brothers and sisters.
Amen.
Don't be afraid of what's going on out there in the world. Let's stay in the church. Because Jesus, according to Ephesians 5:23, is the Savior of the body.
Amen.
So as we close, Psalms 23, verse 1, the Lord is my shepherd. I shall not miss. God's love is provided all our needs in Christ Jesus. He has given us his word. He has told us the good news according to 1 Corinthians 15:1-4. He has already put down the cost. He paid the cost. Jesus paid the cost with his blood upon Calvary. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 7. In whom we have redemption through his blood and forgiveness of sins according to the riches of his grace.
Amen.
It is the blood of Christ that redeems. That's what God's love has provided.
Yes.
Paul says in Romans chapter 1, verse 16, that I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ.
Yes.
For in it is the power of God unto salvation. To the Jew first and also to the Greek. And then it reveals the righteousness of God from faith to faith. For it is written, the just shall live by faith. Brothers and sisters, those of us who have put on Christ in the watery grave of baptism, who are members of the body of Christ, we are told by Peter in 1 Peter 1, 22-23, see, you have purified your souls with the unfeigned love of the Lord. We need to make sure that we are standing firm in God's provision. He says, seeing you have purified your souls in obeying the truth through the Spirit unto the unfeigned love of the brethren, see that you love one another with a pure and fervent
heart.
Born again, not of corruptible seed, but of incorruptible, by the word of God. God is provided. We shall not. So what do you keep? Find yourself outside the love of God. You have transgressed God's law. You have been walking, I have not been walking according to the commandments, statutes, and testimonies of the Lord Jesus Christ.
You are on a fellowship. The Bible still teaches us that if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. But if you hear, you have not put on Christ. God's love is already provided. What are you waiting for? All you have to do is hear the gospel message concerning the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. You have heard it. You need to respond to it. You need to believe. And it's not just belief only. But we need to believe on the one whom God sent, according to John chapter 6, verse 28-29. And Jesus says, he that believes and is baptized shall be saved. And he puts you in that place where God's love abounds, and that's the church, the body of Christ, the church of Christ, the kingdom of God's dear Son. And if you're found faithful, you will receive a crown of life. The Lord is our shepherd. What more do we want? Praise God. If you're here, won't you come and stand? If you're standing in need of prayer, won't you come? We stand and sing the song of
On that trust in